In this short video, let's take a comparative look at endogenous versus exogenous liquidity. To understand the difference between the two, let's take a step back and actually take a look at first the impact of transaction or asset liquidity on the computation of the VAR. Now, when we had done these approaches for VAR estimation, the starting point or the input to these approaches was the time series of the PL or the returns. Specifically speaking, let's say if I am talking about a long position, then I know that the PL for that long position over a period from T to T plus 1 can be computed as the price or the valuation of your position at the time you exit this position, or let's say liquidate this position, minus the price or the valuation which it took for you to enter the position. What I am ignoring here is any income that you might have realized over this period T to T plus 1. Now, when you build a model like this, then the model works with a mid price, because that's how textbooks model any price or a valuation level, okay, an MTM level. In reality, what happens is that the mid price is rather a fictional price. You're never able to realize it. What you do see in the market in terms of the quotes that you observe something called a bid price and you observe something called the ask price. From a market maker's perspective, we know that the bid price is the price at which the market maker is willing to buy. That means you are selling, he is buying. And the ask price is the price at which the market maker is willing to sell. That means you are buying and he is selling. The market maker then makes an income, which is the difference between the two. That means P ask minus P bid. Now, remember this as a memory aid, that P ask is always greater than the P bid and P mid is the average of the two. There's one more way in which you can capture the spread, and that's not as a dollar spread like this, but rather as a spread which is a percentage or a proportion of the P mid. That means it's defined as the dollar bid ask spread that divided by the prevailing P mid. Now, keeping this in mind, if you were to come back to your PL, then if you were to really write down an expression which is for the realized PNL, then that should use a realized value of the final valuation or the price. For a long position in which at the end of the holding period or the horizon, you end up selling your position, that means that in this quote system of P bid and P ask, you will actually be hitting the P bid. Okay, so that means PT plus 1 realized will be the bid price. Now, how do I get the bid price from the mid price? Start from the mid price and move to the left. That means there's a minus sign here. Half the spread. And here I'm assuming that the spread is modeled as a proportion of the P mid. That means I'll do minus half the S times P mid. Okay. Now, what does this have in store for us as far as the VAR level is concerned? Now, if you are talking about a long position, losses which the VAR is trying to project or estimate will happen when the PT plus 1 is lower than PT, when PT plus 1 starts to fall relative to PT. Okay. Now, when that happens, and simultaneously you also switch to a bid price, take a look at what's happening. The bid price is further lower than the mid price by this amount, which means that the losses, once you have taken into account the impact of liquidity, would be higher when you switch from the mid to the bid. Okay. Now, you can ask this question, what if it was a short position? If it was a short position, you could have written down your PNL as the price at which you sold your borrowed asset as of today, minus the price or the MTM at which you, let's say, bought the asset back to cover your short. You bought it back at this price and gave it back to the guy from whom you borrowed it. Okay. When you write down the expression for the realized PNL, you would write it as PT minus the realized PT plus 1. And in the case of a short position, the realized PT plus 1, which is the price at the end of the horizon, would be the ask price at that point in time. Because in this quote system, you will be hitting the ask price because you will be buying and the market maker will be selling. Okay. So therefore, if you were to write down the P ask in terms of P mid, you will write it as P mid and then move to the right by half the spread. Okay. Now, as we did this for the long position, what impact would switch to P ask have on your losses? In the case of a short position, losses start to happen if the final realized price is higher as compared to the price at which you sold the asset as of today. And if you switch from P mid to P ask, your P ask is actually further higher than P mid. And therefore, switching from P mid to P ask, we say further accentuates your losses. And therefore, once you liquidity adjust your VAR, it'll be higher than the VAR, which does not take the bid ask into account. Okay. So this was the impact of VAR, impact of asset slash transaction liquidity on the VAR computation. Now let's come to this, and that is, we have written everything in terms of the S. Now, what is this S and how is it determined? We had said that this S is like a spread which is modeled as proportion to the P mid, number one. Now, number two, think of this S to be a random variable, the same way as PT plus 1 is, the mid PT plus 1, because you do not know what this S will be at the time you are in the market to liquidate your position, either to buy it or to sell it. In terms of factors which affect the S, number one, the first factor is the current economic environment at that point in time. It can be a normal environment, it can be a stressed environment. Number two, and that's an important determinant, and that is the size or the quantity of the trade that you are willing to put on. Now, keep one thing in mind, when it comes to transaction liquidity, the size or the quantity of the trade always goes against you, which means that if you enter the market with a huge buy sized trade or a huge sell sized trade, you are therefore in for moving the market in a way such that the price that you finally realize is always against you. I'll sort of, you know, further dig into this point when we reach this third point. Okay. Then another factor which determines the S is the time for liquidation. How much time are you allowing the market to absorb your trade? Are you doing a fire sale or are you liquidating your total position in small chunks? Now that also affects the S. And then the last determinant in this list is P mid. Now there can be a dependence, I'm saying, between the S and the P mid of your asset as well. Now let's come back to differentiating between endogenous versus exogenous. To do that, what we've done here is that we have plotted the P ask and the P mid as a function of the trade size or quantity, and we have done it for two different assets, a liquid asset and an illiquid asset. Now let's take a look at these two graphs and try and observe a few things which we have to keep in mind. First thing, P mid, we have plotted that as the average of P ask and P bid, we know that. P ask is higher than P bid, we know that. The next thing to observe here is that when you enter the market with a certain sized trade, then up until this threshold amount Q star, which we refer to as a normal market size, the spread that you observe between the P ask and P bid does not depend on the size of the trade. That means the market can absorb trades up until this level Q star before the P ask and the P bid start getting affected by the size of your trade. Okay, so this is that normal market level which you have to keep in mind. Next, what happens is that as the size of your trade goes beyond this Q star, you will observe that the P ask, which is the price that you hit upon when you are in the market to buy, starts to go up. Okay. So as the trade becomes bigger and bigger, you are paying more and more for actually buying these large quantities of this asset. And that's why I said the market starts to move against you. The same thing happens If you are in the market for selling, because that's when you are hitting upon the P bid, and if your Q starts to move beyond this Q star, then the price which you eventually hit, I mean the P bid, becomes lower and lower, and therefore again we are saying the market is going against you. Okay, now comes comparing the illiquid with the liquid. The first thing that you will notice, the spread is much bigger, and I'm talking about that difference in spreads which is, let's say, to the left of Q star. So that spread is already quite high. Now second thing to observe is the Q star, the threshold level at which the P ask and the P bid get affected by this Q, is much lower. Okay, take a look at this portion. It's, you know, this portion is much accentuated in the case of liquid position as it is for the case of illiquid. It's a very short area, or, you know, very small Q star where the spread stays relatively constant. Then third thing to observe, as the Q becomes greater than Q star, this curve is much steeper. That means the market impact of larger sized trades is much higher. As the Q, you know, becomes greater than Q star and you further increase the Q, the price increases or decreases much more rapidly. Okay, these are a few things which we can observe for liquid versus illiquid. Now comes the difference between endogenous and exogenous. Even before moving further, I can define this difference verbally speaking as this. Exogenous liquidity is one which is, let's say, served to you on a platter. Okay, it's like liquidity which is actually, you can say, controlled by factors which are beyond your control. Okay, that means it is something which is agreeably a random number. I'm not saying that S is known to you. S is still random, but it's not determined by your own actions. It's determined by the market and it's served to you. You just come and act on it. Okay, endogenous, comparatively speaking, happens when you are affected by your own trade as well. Okay, so S that you observe may not just be controlled or determined by factors which are beyond your control, but also by factors which are totally under your control, and which is the size of the position which you are trying to liquidate. Okay, so therefore this would happen if, let's say, you are in this region of the size of the trades. When you are in this region, your trade also is moving the market. Okay, and that's where we are referring to endogenous liquidity. Okay, now let's go back to the previous page where we, you know, tried to find the link between VAR estimation and liquidity related aspects. We had said that depending on whether our position is a long position or whether it's a short position, we need to move from the P mid to the P bid in the case of long and the P ask in the case of short, okay, respectively. And therefore the relations that we arrived at was this. Now if I am trying to estimate the VAR, right, and therefore these prices which I have written here are prices as of the end of the horizon, then those prices are something which I don't know, number one. Number two, in these prices, I have also included the S, and S is also, I have told you, it's like a random number. I do not know what kind of factors will be prevailing at the time I am in the market to liquidate my position, and hence S is also random. Okay, therefore, what distinguishes endogenous versus exogenous is this. This is also something which we have to keep in mind to understand the relative difficulty level of the models that deal with exogenous and endogenous. In the case of endogenous, what will happen is that S is random, yes, but we are operating in a region where S is affected by the size of the trade that you are doing, which is Q. Okay, it's such a large sized trade that the market maker, you know, adjusts the S at which he is willing to trade with you. Okay, Q also impacts the P mid. Why? Because of very simple, demand and supply. Okay, and therefore Q is like a single factor sitting in the middle of S and P mid, and it's controlling both of these. Okay, so if you come back to this relation in which P mid was random, so was S. In the case of endogenous liquidity, we are talking about a case where these two random variables are dependent on one another. There is some kind of dependence between the two, and that dependence is controlled by the Q, for example. Okay, Therefore, I would imagine that models which deal with endogenous liquidity would be much harder to, let's say, fathom and even, you know, think of and implement, basically. Okay. So that is about the relative difference in terms of modeling. Also, keep one thing in mind: when it comes to exogenous, I am assuming that there is, let's say, no dependence between these two random guys. So therefore, I can choose this random guy, let's say, as a worst case random S, quite independently from the worst case P mid, for example. Okay. And therefore, the exogenous would be a much simpler kind of a model to work with. Okay. Now, in this short video, therefore, what we've done is we have tried to take a comparative look between endogenous versus exogenous liquidity. And we did it with, you know, proper ample support from first understanding how the VAR is affected by the transaction liquidity. Okay.